Hello, I'm Kim Freeman, and welcome to St. David's Bible Study. Greetings to the Roomies and the Zoomies and the YouTubies. And if you're viewing this online for the first time, if you'll contact the church at parishadmin@stdavidchurch.org, we'll make sure you can get the free study materials. You can join in with us. So let's open up with prayer. Father, I thank you so much for the gift of technology that we can gather together and just study your word. And I'm praying that our Christmases can be extra special this year because Luke's words just swim in our head and live in our heart, and they speak a beautiful truth to us. In Jesus' name, amen. So please open your Bibles to Luke chapter 12 and follow along with me. So while a large crowd was listening to Jesus, verse 1 says that he began to speak first to his disciples. He said, "Be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees." Well, just as yeast works its way through dough, so a small amount of evil can affect a large group of people. The yeast of the Pharisees, which was their hypocrisy, could permeate and contaminate, leaving the entire nation astray. So Jesus called for transparency and explained the futility of trying to hide the truth. Hypocrites try to cover up their lives, not letting others see who they really are. Well, you can fool people, but you can't fool God. And Jesus is saying in verse 2 that full disclosure will come on Judgment Day. God will bring their secret lives out into the open. Everything will be revealed, known, heard, and proclaimed. So the lesson for the disciples was, since hypocrisy will be exposed, integrity is expected now. Well, as the disciples observed the growing hostility of the religious leaders against Jesus, they might have feared that they too would become targets of wrath, and that would be understandable. So, as if knowing their thoughts, Jesus said in verse 4, "My friends, don't be afraid of those who kill the body and after that can do no more, but I will show you whom you should fear. Fear God, who has the power to throw you into hell." Jesus explained that they might face death for their faith in him, but whatever these opponents did, their ability to cause suffering was limited. Enemies can destroy the body, but not one's soul. So if the disciples were going to be afraid, they should fear God, who has the power to cause suffering for eternity. In verse 6, then Jesus showed that God cares deeply for his own. To illustrate this, Jesus compared people to sparrows. Well, in economic terms, sparrows are not very valuable, but even so, God does not forget a single one. Even the plight of sparrows doesn't escape the compassionate care of their creator. So consequently, Jesus's disciples, whom he values far more than birds, can rest assured that nothing escapes God's attention. God loves his people so much that he cares about the smallest details of their lives, down to knowing the number of hairs on their heads. So I'm thinking he's counting my silver ones now. So when faced with opposition, Jesus's disciples might be tempted to deny their allegiance to him. But for this, Jesus had serious words. Look at verse 8. "Whoever acknowledges me before men, I will acknowledge him before the angels in heaven. But he who disowns me before men will be disowned by me in heaven." Confessing Christ before people implied risk and possible negative consequences, but Jesus promises great reward for those who do. All trials and persecutions for the sake of allegiance to Jesus are worth it. Well, verse 10 deals with people who have not yet come to believe in Jesus. Speaking against the person of Jesus can be forgiven because the insult may be based on ignorance of his true identity. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, who continually rejects the Holy Spirit's convicting influence to believe in Jesus, is beyond redemptive help. They will not be forgiven. And why? Because they will never ask for forgiveness. Whoever rejects the prompting of the Holy Spirit removes himself from the only force that can lead anyone to repentance. That decision has eternal consequences. So if you're worried if you've committed this sin, then be comforted. The unforgivable sin is the deliberate and ongoing rejection of the Holy Spirit's work and of God himself. So if a person fears committing this sin, you show by your very concern that you've not sinned in this way. In verse 11, note that when Jesus said when and not if, so he said when you are brought to trial in the synagogues, they need not worry about what to say in their own defense. Jesus's fishermen turned disciples knew they would never be able to dominate a religious dispute with the well-educated Jewish leaders, and this fear might cause them not to acknowledge Jesus as they should. And so it's as though Jesus said, don't think you have to prepare an eloquent speech, simply speak from the heart. Jesus promised that the Holy Spirit would supply the needed words at the moment the words were needed. Well, in 13, someone in the crowd asked Jesus to take his side in a quarrel with his brother about their dead parents' estate. He wanted Jesus to use his authority to compel his brother to divide the inheritance. Now, Jewish law made the distribution of a man's estate a routine matter. According to Deuteronomy 21:17, the eldest son received a double portion, and then the remainder was equally divided among the living sons. So sort of a no-brainer. So this strongly hints that the man sought more than his fair share. But verse 14 shows that Jesus refused to be drawn into this financial dispute. His mission was too urgent for a task that could just as easily be settled by a rabbi. But he used the man's request as an opportunity to teach about the pitfalls of being greedy. It led him to tell a parable about the folly of laying up treasures on earth. First, Jesus issued a warning to everyone in verse 15. He said, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." In doing so, it was like Jesus was looking right into that man's face, the complaining man, and saying, "I can see right through you. Your request shows how greedy you are," is what Jesus implied, because that led him to tell a story of a farmer that everyone would envy. His land was very productive and it yielded a good crop. Well, in verse 17, the farmer pondered a problem. He thought to himself, "What should I do? I've harvested so much grain that I don't have enough space to store it all." Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods." So he patted himself on the back, not only for having a bumper crop, but also for what he thought was wise storage and estate planning. He thought he had it made. The problem was not his success. God didn't condemn his decision to plan ahead. The error was that the man did not thank God for the sun and the rain and the rich soil that grew his bountiful harvest. It didn't even occur to him to ask God for direction on what he should do with his riches. Instead, he made his own decisions, as verse 19 shows. He said, "I'll say to myself, you have plenty of good things laid up for many years." Sadly, the man relied on accumulated goods for his security rather than depending on God. He didn't care about others. He hoarded for private use. He built larger barns rather than share his surplus with those who had none. His goal was to retire early instead of helping those who struggle. Furthermore, he said to himself, "I'll take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry." His words reflected hedonism, selfishness, and self-indulgence. His daydream was to indulge his whims and maximize his pleasure. With no eternal perspective, this man's life was completely focused on the temporal. Verse 20 begins with two very dire words, "but God." And when you see the words "but God" in scripture, a dramatic reversal is about to occur. The man was self-centered and used his resources in a way that displeased God. The farmer's life was lacking any spiritual aspect. And that night, his folly was made plain to him because God said, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you." Jesus calls the man a fool, meaning one who either acts without God or acts without wisdom in a self-destructive way. For all his forecasting, this unwise man failed to plan for the one, common to all, sure to happen event that each person must face: death. Jesus said, "Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself?" Ironically, others will enjoy the financial prosperity of his early retirement. This is the ultimate "you can't take it with you" parable. And so in verse 21, Jesus stated this point of the story. The rich man stored up treasure for himself. The possessions and comfort pursued by this rich fool led him to neglect the pursuit of God. He thought that life consisted of accumulating things and that death was far away. The future was his, so he thought, but God. The rich man had a fatal flaw. He'd forgotten to put God at the center of his life, concerned for no one but himself. When the time came for him to stand before God, he had not prepared himself for eternity, and that was his most foolish mistake. So in verse 21, what does the phrase "is not rich toward God" mean? It means to fail to acknowledge gratefully that everything we have comes from God, and to make an effort to use what he gives us for the good of others and for the glory of God. Because wealth can be enjoyed and employed at the same time if our purpose is to honor God. How tragic to be rich in this world, but poor in the next. So the story holds up a mirror to us and asks us to take a good look at our own earthly assets and ask how we are using them. Well, from the issue of greed and selfishness, Jesus turns to that of worry. You know, greed can never get enough, but worry is afraid it won't have enough. So in verse 22, Jesus encouraged his disciples to observe nature and understand that God is in the business of caring for the needs of all his creation. Twice Jesus said the word consider. Consider the ravens, consider the lilies. To consider is to ponder, to give deliberate thought to. God feeds the ravens of the sky, clothes the lilies of the field, and gives splendor to the grass. If God cares for such relatively insignificant things as birds and flowers, will he not feed and clothe his own beloved children? To worry about such things is useless, because worry cannot add a single hour to your life. Even grass, which lives for a short period and then is cast into fire, is cared for and clothed by God. I like something that Corrie Ten Boom said. She said, "Worry does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow. It empties today of its strength." That's so true. Well, in 29, Jesus wants believers to trust God. This approach to life, he said, is different than the pagan world, which goes through life chasing after these things. In contrast, the Father knows what his children need. In verse 31, Jesus calls for a single issue to be the disciples' major concern: God's kingdom. And God will care for all the rest. And there is tucked away that famous verse, "Seek his kingdom and all these things will be given to you as well." Well, in verse 32, Jesus referred to them as a little flock, helpless animals that need supervision, protection, and constant care. The disciples had nothing to fear because their good shepherd never failed to protect them and was faithful to provide. So we're not to fear putting God's kingdom first before all our other desires, because Jesus said, and I underlined these words in my Bible, I loved it, "It is God's good pleasure to bless and to provide for his own." I love that. Well, which leads to the next thought in verse 33. If we don't need to worry about the provisions of life, then we can be generous with what God has given us. Jesus said that as believers shared their earthly possessions with the poor, they would be storing up treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So Jesus now shifts the emphasis from being anxious about the present to being watchful about the future. And his teaching presents two themes: first, his return, and second, faithful service. So in verse 35, Jesus discusses faithful service. He said, "Be dressed and ready for service and keep your lamps burning." Did you know that part of the treasure we store up in heaven comes from faithful service? It's not just giving money. Your faithful service counts. The command, "be dressed and ready for service," pictures a person in Bible times who has tucked his long outer robe into his belt so he can be ready to run, travel, fight, or work. The command, "keep your lamps burning," urges the disciples to keep themselves in a perpetual state of awareness, to be on constant watch. Do you know that a disciple of Jesus is always on call, always alert for opportunities of service in God's kingdom? Well, Jesus explains this readiness with an illustration. In verse 36, he says, "Be like the men who are waiting for their master to return from a wedding banquet. I learned that Jewish wedding feasts can take up to a week, so when the master returns, he shouldn't have to bang on his own outer gates like a beggar. Let me in. The steward should assign a lookout who would alert the rest of the household when the master appears on the horizon. A servant should be posted to open the gate upon his arrival and guide him into the house with lighted lamps. The house should have been kept clean and the daily chores completed diligently, and the table should be set with a welcoming meal. If so, then verse 37 contains a twist, a surprising reversal for those faithful servants who were watching. Upon his arrival, the master will be so pleased with their faithfulness that he will dress himself to serve, will have them recline at the table, and will come and wait on them. Do you know that this is an allusion to the great messianic feast, the banquet that's described in Revelation 19:9, where it says, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. Such a reversal of roles will happen in God's future kingdom. Such a welcome and a reward will await those faithful followers who were ready and who lived in eager anticipation of Jesus's return. And verse 38 was saying this, even more commendable is the fact that the servants are ready even in the second and the third night of watch of the night, times when one is not normally prepared. Well, in Jesus' second example, in verse 39, there is not the joyful return of the expected master, but the surprise break-in of an unexpected thief. Burglars don't announce the time and place of their next invasion, so the homeowner must remain alert at all times. Now, just so you know, Jesus neither equated himself to a thief nor characterized his return as malicious. His point was this. He was alluding to his own unexpected visit. So this illustration warns of the alternative. In contrast to the first example where the servants were watching and waiting, for some, the master's coming will be like the approach of a thief in the night. They won't be prepared. They're unconcerned, uninterested in the master's return, content living their lives for themselves. So Jesus warns his audience to be ready, for he will be the one who will come when least expected. And then I love Peter, speaking for the group as he always does. In verse 41, he wondered to whom Jesus was addressing this parable about being prepared for the kingdom's arrival. Lord, are you telling this to us 12 disciples or to everyone in the crowd? And then I love how in verse 42, Jesus answered Peter's question with another question. He said, who is the faithful and wise manager? You see, lest we get the idea that watching and waiting are all that Jesus requires, he told this parable to encourage us to be working when he comes. Three W's, like on the whiteboard, watching, waiting, and working. So here's the scenario. A master needed to leave for an extended time. He put a manager in charge, gave specific work assignments, provided for the needs of all his workers, and promised to return. Thus, the master is Jesus, who will leave his servants for a while to serve while he's gone. Well, what would the master find when he returned? Hopefully, he would find faithful servants working, knowing that they would be evaluated. Because he says in verse 43, it will be good for that servant whom the master finds doing so when he returns. Blessing comes to that servant who has done his job well, and he will be promoted to serve in a higher capacity. So the disciples had a special responsibility to feed God's household, his church, but each of us has some work to do assigned to us by the Lord. So when Jesus returns, his faithful servant leaders will be given assignments of prominence in his kingdom. Well, my commentaries told me at verse 45, because I was puzzled here and you might have been as well. It was hard to tell whether this was a brand new parable about masters and servants or just a further interpretation of the one we just read about the master returning from the wedding banquet. I learned you can read it either way. So while the first parable emphasized remaining faithful and alert, this second parable focuses on rewards and punishments given to the servants after their master's absence. In contrast to the faithful servants, Jesus now illustrated three irresponsible servants. In verse 45, the first servant was the most rebellious and abusive to others. He took advantage of his position of authority to beat the other servants. Instead of caring for them and giving them their rations, he did the opposite, beating and abusing them and selfishly indulging in all kinds of excess consumption. This servant committed two errors. First, he said to himself, "I'll do as I please while my master's away. I'll eat, drink, and get drunk." And second, he says, "And I have plenty of time to put things right before my master returns, for he's taking a long time in coming." Well, his assumptions were fatally flawed. He could not do as he pleased, and he had less time than he thought. When the master returned, the servant's deliberate defiance was severely punished. He was cut into pieces and assigned a place with the unbelievers. This pictures the end time judgment, where the faithful ones enter God's kingdom, but the unfaithful ones are sent away. The warning about this servant is, if we stop looking for Jesus, we stop loving his people. In verse 47, the second servant also understood the master's will, but he failed to do what he'd been told. Such a servant was also disciplined harshly and beaten with many blows. In verse 48, the third servant didn't know his master's instructions and was disciplined less severely. He was beaten with few blows. The point is, all three were judged and held accountable in varying degrees for what they had known and then what they'd done. So Jesus was warning the people about a day of accounting because knowledge bears a tremendous responsibility. So the lesson for believers in verse 48 is this: from everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. So clearly, leadership in God's kingdom, whether it is small or large, is taken very seriously by God. Those placed in positions where they will guide, influence, and care for others and have been entrusted with much, therefore, God has high expectations for their lives. Finally, Jesus provides the answer to Peter's question. Accountability and preparedness apply to every believer, yet the requirements are more serious for the disciples in leadership. Well, in verse 49, as Jesus drew closer to Jerusalem, he expressed a yearning for the unfolding of God's plan of salvation. He said, "I've come to bring fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled." Maybe they'll seem like puzzling words. Jesus lamented that God's plan of redemption must tolerate the presence of evil for a time. But out of his great compassion, Jesus was expressing a willingness to complete his task. He just has to wait for God's timing. We get a glimpse here of Jesus's humanity as he shows his feelings of distress at what must happen in order for that fire to be kindled. He said in verse 50 that he would have to undergo a baptism. That doesn't mean the Jordan River one. It's referring here to the ordeal of Gethsemane, the cross, and the tomb before his triumphant resurrection. So even though it brought suffering and death, Jesus earnestly sought to fulfill the divine plan and play his part. Well, verse 51 shows us that no one can sit on the fence about Jesus. Decisions have to be made to believe or not to believe. He said, "Do you think I came to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, division." Why? Because he demands a response. Families and generations will be divided against one another and torn apart when some choose to follow him and others refuse to do so. Loyalty to Jesus has to take precedence even over the dearest loyalties on earth. Why does the gospel always divide? Because it is a call to switch sides in a spiritual war. The kingdom of God has declared war on the kingdom of Satan. And so Jesus issued a warning in verse 54. However much we may wish to eliminate the element of judgment from the message of Jesus, it remains stubbornly there. The people should have recognized that the Messiah was in their midst. He chastised their failure to evaluate their times. Ample evidence was there, but they failed to take hold of the truth. Jesus compared observing his ministry to noting the daily weather patterns. A cloud forming over the Mediterranean always brought moist air or rain. A south wind from the desert always brought scorching heat. Likewise, Jesus's audience knew Old Testament prophecies concerning the Messiah, and they'd witnessed his miracles and heard his teachings, but they were slow and dull of mind in understanding spiritual signs. He said, "You don't know how to interpret this present time." He's referring to his works and his warnings as sign that the kingdom of God was at hand and judgment was near. And so that's why he closed with the words about a lawsuit in verse 58. The point is, Israel's situation is as desperate now as that of one who is going to court to face his accuser. The assumption is that the defendant has a pretty bad case, which is going to go against him. The point is that people should recognize the urgency of the moment and make every effort to settle with their accuser. Because once at the mercy of the legal system, a debtor had little hope. He'd be dragged before a judge, thrown into prison from which there was no escape. So the only prudent thing to do was settle with one's accuser before the matter came to court. What is Jesus saying in simple words? Every man has a bad case in the presence of God, the judge of the universe, and if he's wise, he will make his peace with God while there is time. God's prison has no parole or release, and every sentence in his justice system is eternal. So Jesus was stating that all people are guilty of sin and will face an eternal judge one day. He's urging them to confess their sins now and settle their account or their relationship with God now in order to avoid the coming judgment. And how? By repenting and believing in him. So in summary, Luke gave us believers five warnings in today's chapter. In the image of yeast, he said, beware of hypocrisy. In the parable of the rich fool, beware of greed. In the illustrations of sparrows and lilies, beware of worry. In the parable of servants with an absent master, beware of spiritual carelessness. And in the example of weather signs in a lawsuit, beware of spiritual dullness. So let's read the summary for Luke chapter 12. After a passage denouncing the Pharisees and scribes for hypocrisy, which was last week's lesson, comes a passage in which Jesus warns his disciples of the identical problem. Why? Because perhaps the disciples were facing temptation. With Jesus's popularity ever increasing, and with the completion of their own successful mission trips, the limelight of fame was shining on them. It might be easy to mimic the Pharisees' hypocritical behavior if they weren't careful. Things like acting religiously superior, judging others, harboring pride, and parading a false self-righteousness in front of people. Jesus sternly warned his disciples of this yeast, this evil that spread easily to others. He then described a proper devotion to God, which trusted in his care. He gave them four commands: beware of hypocrisy, fear God rather than opponents, confess Christ openly, and do not worry. Well, a person from the crowd asked Jesus to arbitrate a dispute. Instead of addressing the matter, Jesus exposed the greedy motives of the man and revealed God's perspective on the foolishness of greed. The parable described a person who was solely concerned with himself, his welfare, pleasure, and security. He displayed no gratitude toward God or a willingness to share with those less fortunate. The parable exposed the poverty of his abundance. His ingratitude invoked God's anger and led to severe judgment. If a person won't distribute his resources to others in his life, God will do it after the person's death. Can you scroll up? Thank you. And so the moral of the story is this: fools spend all their time storing up treasures for themselves, but neglect to become rich toward God. Hoarding money without compassionate giving, viewing property as one's own, not God's, or basing security on possessions rather than God's provision are all examples of spiritual poverty, not being rich toward God. Being rich toward God means using the wealth he provides to fulfill his priorities. People who are rich in this way love God and are filled with a passion to obey and serve him and give to others. Their treasures are handed back to God for his use in furthering his kingdom. Well, Jesus addresses man's anxiety about survival needs, food and clothing. Ravens do not worry about food, and yet they eat. The lilies do not worry about clothes, but they're more splendid than King Solomon. His splendor was no match for the simple beauty of a lily. If grass in the fields is splendidly clothed, yet is here today and gone tomorrow, will not God take care of his own who are of eternal value to him? The pagan world runs after all such things. See, without an awareness of God's presence, they scurry endlessly after physical concerns. But believers have an eternal perspective that is focused on the kingdom to come. They trust their Father to know what they need. So Jesus said that instead of worrying about the basics of life, seek his kingdom and the basics will be added to you. With this priority, God's children can trust that God will always care for them. Jesus wasn't telling his followers to sell all their possessions, but rather to sell whatever they could to make giving to the poor possible. Whatever occupies a person's thoughts and consumes his time, that is the person's treasure. The heart will be with the treasure. The person whose treasure is in heaven can hold loosely to whatever treasures God has given them in this world. So Jesus warns about preparing for his coming. He illustrated spiritual readiness with two different examples. The first scenario involved the arrival of someone expected. The second, someone unexpected. So let's look at the expected one. Jesus has just stated that the Father is pleased to give you the kingdom. Waiting for the day when God will give them the kingdom requires both faith and vigilance. God's people must be dressed for action with their lamps lit. Faithful servants would stay awake while waiting for their master's return from a banquet. The lamps are lit so they can light his way into his room without delay. No matter how late the master may come, the servants are prepared to open the door immediately upon his arrival. In the same way, God's people must be awaiting his arrival so they too can welcome him the moment he arrives. And then here's the other. This describes the need for constant vigilance as believers await the kingdom. A homeowner doesn't know when a burglar is coming to break into his house. If the homeowner did, he'd be ready and would prevent it from happening. Likewise, God's people must be ready all the time. Jesus left no doubt that he would be the one who will come when least expected. Read these three wonderful verses. So not only should believers watch for Jesus, we must also work for Jesus, as the rest of the parable reveals. The master is Jesus, who will leave his servants in his household, the earth, to serve while he'll be gone. All the slaves must work, although some are given more responsibility and thus more accountability. Those slaves who are hard at work when the master returns will be blessed and given more responsibility. And then Jesus warns about coming division. Jesus's "I have come" statements summarizes ministry. Jesus came to earth to bring division, not peace. That is because Jesus confronts everyone with a choice. Will you believe in him or will you reject him? There is no middle ground, as we discovered last week. Such choices cause division and opposition even among families. And Jesus warns about the future. You know, right here, Jesus was beginning his final appeal to the nation of Israel to repent. Remember, he's on his way to Jerusalem to die. So here he urged the crowd to reflect on their skills of discernment. They knew that clouds forming in the west over the Mediterranean Sea would bring rain. Wind blowing in from the desert to the south would bring hot weather. People interpreted these signs and prepared themselves accordingly. But these same people were ignoring the signs of the coming kingdom that surrounded Jesus. They did not assess his miracles or his teachings properly. In calling them hypocrites, he was trying to shock them into reflection, as if to say, "How can you miss all that is going on around you in my ministry?" Their poor judgment left them at great risk. Why weren't they taking advantage of this opportunity to make peace with God? They ought to do so, for waiting could be disastrous, just as the man on his way to court would be wise to settle the matter beforehand. That was wiser than waiting for the judge's verdict to be handed down. God's judgment is irreversible. Each person must decide what to do about Jesus. He called the Jews to accept him before their time ran out. So we will meet again in January, chapter Luke 13, and it's full of some more important teachings to his disciples. It's a great lesson. I hope you have a blessed Christmas. God bless you. See you in January.